This presentation discusses the pathogenesis, diagnosis, and management of acne vulgaris. The lesson objectives include the understanding of the pathogenesis of acne, identification of the clinical features, improvement of diagnostic skills, development of a management plan, and understanding the various therapeutic modalities in acne. Acne is described as a common, chronic, and recurrent inflammatory disorder of the pilosebaceous follicle, resulting from an androgen-induced increased sebum production, resulting in hyperkeratosis of the pilosebaceous duct, increase in abnormal follicular bacterial activity, resulting in inflammation and scarring. Acne begins with the emergence of androgens, which influences the pilosebaceous unit, resulting in abnormal and increased production of sebum and fatty acids, resulting in hyperkeratinization of the pilosebaceous follicle. This results in a partial obstruction called microcomedones. From there, sebum continues to accumulate, enlarging the follicle and resulting in a mature keratinous plug. When this plug is formed very close to the epidermis, it is called an open comedone or a blackhead. Where this plug is produced lower down in the dermis portion of the follicle, this results in a closed comedone or a whitehead. At the same time, the increase in abnormal activity of Propionibacterium acnes bacteria results in a cellular and cytokine-mediated inflammation, resulting in inflammatory lesions of acne. The diagnostic features of acne are based on the clinical signs and the distribution. The clinical signs include comedones, inflammatory lesions of papules, pustules, nodules, and cysts. There is often an increased production of oil, resulting in seborrhea of the face. Acne is commonly found on the face, chest, and back, and often first appears around puberty. The clinical classification of acne would be comedonal, superficial inflammatory, deep inflammatory, and nodular cystic acne. In this picture, which shows mainly comedonal non-inflammatory acne, one can see multiple close comedones or whiteheads and scattered open comedones or blackheads. In superficial inflammatory acne, comedones are present, but however, they are much more prominent papules and pustules, and you will notice in this patient the oiliness of the skin. Deep inflammatory acne consists of not only pustules and papules, but also larger nodular lesions. Nodular cystic acne has a combination of comedones, nodules, but also cyst and coalescing cyst called acne conglobata. These lesions are usually painful and tender. It is important in the management of acne to have an appropriate assessment of the patient. This includes the history of acne, past and present medical history, a menstrual history and marital status in women, a drug history, a family history, especially of acne, and a proper clinical examination of the extent and severity of the lesions. Acne can cause significant psychological morbidity. It is important, therefore, to engage the patient to discuss his or her issues, concerns, expectations, and impact of illness on the patient. The vast majority of patients with acne have normal hormonal levels. However, when a patient with acne presents with features of thinning of hair, increased facial hair or hirsutism, increased body weight, and irregular menstrual period, it is prudent to investigate the patient for hyperandrogenization or polycystic ovary syndrome. The goals of therapy in acne management. Acne management can be divided into a clearance phase therapy and a maintenance phase therapy. In the clearance phase therapy, there is active management of acne for prevention of scars, clearance of all clinical lesions, and management of the psychological aspects of the patient. When the acne is in remission, one has to institute a prevention or maintenance program by continued use of topicals and management of scars. Therapeutic strategies in acne management. It is important to have an accurate diagnosis and a proper assessment before starting treatment. We need to discuss with the patient her issues, concerns, expectations, the psychological impact, the facts about acne, and the myths. In management of acne, a strong therapeutic relationship between the patient and the doctor is essential. Plan is developed after a shared decision-making process to reach a consensus according to preference of the patient and the medical indications. Plan is then executed and the patient regularly followed up for benefits and side effects. Where there is poor response, there has to be a review of the plan and restarting a new therapeutic regimen. Topical retinoids are an important component in the management of acne. They act on abnormal keratinization of the follicle and are also anti-inflammatory. They work both for inflammatory and comedonal acne. However, in inflammatory acne, it is known that topical retinoids can induce skin irritation. Topical antimicrobials. These act directly on P. acne and thus reduces inflammation. Combinations of antimicrobials and retinoids make for more convenient treatment, thus promoting adherence to therapy. Oral antibiotics. The preferred oral antibiotics are the tetracycline group. They are shown to be effective in reducing the size and the number of inflammatory lesions. It usually takes 6 to 8 weeks of antibiotic to show the effects of treatment. Combination oral contraceptives with antiandrogens are a useful choice for women with acne and the need for oral contraception. Combination oral contraceptives with antiandrogens, which are extremely useful for patients with irregular periods and exacerbation of acne around the menstrual period, cannot be the primary therapeutic agent. They must be used in combination with topical or oral anti-acne therapy. Oral isotretinoin is an extremely effective agent in the management of acne. It is the only agent that has an impact on the size and the activity of the sebaceous gland. The main indications are for nodular cystic acne. However, they are extremely useful for superficial and deep inflammatory acne where there is evidence of scarring, poor response to oral antibiotics, or quick relapses after a course of antibiotics. The dosage varies between 0.5 to 1.5 mg depending on the severity, extent, and the tolerance of the patient of the side effects. The duration is for 16 to 24 weeks. The aim of therapy is to achieve complete clearance of the lesions. It is important to spend a considerable time discussing the side effects of oral isotretinoin before starting treatment, the most important of which is teratogenicity. It is contraindicated in women who would like to start a family or in women who are sexually active without an appropriate contraception.